Hi Chris, you send me live. Hi, my name is Belle and I am the marketing brand manager here at City and Islington College. Welcome to today's virtual Q&A Facebook live session for the Angel campus. So the campus focuses on A-level courses and vocational courses for the sciences. Before we begin the event, I'm just going to briefly explain the format so you know what's to follow. So over the course of the next hour and a half or so, I will present to you various speakers, teachers and curriculum specialists who will talk about their areas of expertise and the subjects they teach. While they present to you on screen, you will have the option of using the online Q&A facility and typing any questions you may have about what they're talking about on screen. That's on the right-hand side of your actual screen. So you can type in as many questions as you like. We will moderate those questions and publish them to the presenter at the time. However, we may not be able to present every question to them. So if you could just leave your email address in the chat facility, we will contact you once the event finishes so that you get all the relevant information. So as well as the Q&A facility, you also have access to a schedule for today. That's on the college website under the Open Days page. So that lists all the times and each curriculum area, so you can dip in and out of the event as you see fit, or you're more than welcome to stay for the whole duration. A video will actually go up of this event on the college website should you miss any vital information as well. Okay, before we, also a bit about the college itself. City and Islington College is part of a wider group called the Capital City College Group. That comprises of three very unique colleges: one City and Islington College, Westminster Kingsway College, and the College of North East London. All in all, across the group, we have 24,000 students, we have 1,700 members of staff, and we have 11 centres across North London. So, any learner coming into the group, we can safely say, has ample opportunity in terms of the courses we offer them, the work opportunities that are available, and we also do apprenticeships. We have higher education courses as well. So now I would now like to hand you over to Dominic Adey, who is the curriculum director at the Angel campus, who will be focusing on talking about the A levels and the vocational courses we offer here in sciences. Hi Dominic, how are you today?
Well, I'm very well. Thank you, Val, for your introduction on
You're
this rather cold and wet June morning. So welcome very much to the Open Day here at the Angel campus. We're doing it online, as you can tell. It'd be great if we could see there at the building, but here we are online. So I'm going to go through a few opening points about the Angel campus and what we offer our students. Now, as you can see, we have a wide range of A-level and BTEC subjects, and I'll be going through some of those a little bit later. We have excellent support for our students, first and foremost through the tutorial system, a bit like you have a form tutor at school. We have great enrichment opportunities to add on to the curriculum, so lots of clubs and societies you can take part in. And we have very high standard facilities. I'm going to be talking about these as we go this morning. So I'm just going to move on to next page in just a second.
So Dominic, how many A levels do we do at the centre?
That's an excellent question. We have 36 in total. Sorry, just onto the next slide. Of those 36 subjects, students take three. That's the usual number. And so that's your core A-level program. That's conjoined with a tutorial, which is once a week. You meet with your tutor. Your tutor guides you through, looks after you as your first port of call throughout your time at the college. Ultimately, they write your references for university or apprenticeships or workplaces. So you get a good close relationship with your tutor throughout your 2 years. As part of the programme, you may have enrichment, which might be subject based. So if you're doing something like sociology, you might be a part of the sociology club, but there's other activities too, chess club, film club, etc. Work placements, certainly towards the summer end of the first year is where work placements mostly take place, though some take place throughout the year as well, sometimes in half terms, and that's arranged through our careers service. And we have specialist support classes, essentially subject workshops. So if you feel like you need a bit of a boost in a subject, let's say psychology, there are some times set aside in the week for you to meet with psychology staff one to one. So that's how the whole programme fits together for A-levels. Now, just need to move towards the BTEC end in a moment. There, at the moment, you can see all the A-level subjects that we do provide, and there's quite a range across the performing arts, sciences, languages, humanities, and you can see them listed there. And they're all on our website too, with a bit more detail. Also at the Angel Campus, we have a Centre for Applied Sciences, where you can study from a range of science programmes through the BTEC pathway. So BTEC is equivalent to 3 A-levels. So if you're applying for university, it's an equivalent route. But unlike with A-levels where you choose a variety of subjects from that long list that we just saw, with BTECs, you have a core specialism. But that is also backed up again with tutorial support, enrichment, work placements, and with BTECs there's perhaps an even greater emphasis on work placements, as many of them do lead directly into vocational roles, and specialist support classes as well. Now in the BTECs, there are a number of pathways you can take there. The animal management, I can say a bit more about that in a moment. There's the applied science route, engineering, forensic science, the health studies and medical science, public services, so for things like the police, prison service, ambulance service, and sports science as well. The animal management course has quite a large number of animals on site, almost 100 species, including humans. And of course, you can see a range of them there. It would be great to show you them if we were on site, but they're well looked after during lockdown, I assure you. So if you're interested in animal science, it's a great place to be. I mentioned earlier on the support that we offer, particularly through tutorials. You get a dedicated personal tutor, as we said, who keeps you and your parents in touch, keeps you on track, meets with you one-to-one quite regularly, as well as having group tutorials as well. And as you can see, also subject workshops for students who need support. And that might mean because there's a couple of ideas you're not quite sure about, you need a bit of help, or opposite, you feel like actually you need more, you need extra. And so we can push you that way as well. And there's an image there of a psychology workshop in action. There are bursaries available. You can see some details there on the page, a 16 to 19 bursary. You may also be eligible for free school meals. You may have had that at school, but that carries on at college level. Support with travel, zip card, and the student Oyster card as well. And all full-time students receive evidence for parents and carers to continue to receive their child benefit. So that's some points about financial support there. In terms of personal support and well-being, we have a counselling service that you can access 5 days a week, appointments based. We have an inclusion room for students who have particular needs that help them to get integrated with the whole of the student body. On site, we have mental health and well-being support. And I would like to underline that, of course, safeguarding is incredibly important to us. The fact that students feel safe is absolutely at the heart of everything that we do. In terms of enrichment, I mentioned earlier on we have a huge range of clubs and societies, from the Toast magazine, which is an in-house student magazine, and you can see a few other examples just below. Medic Link for people who are thinking of medicine as a career, Legal Action for those who are thinking of the law, but also the LGBTQ+, chess club, table tennis. You can see pictures of sport activities and our performance as well. Last December, we did a very large college production of Chicago, the musical. Our facilities, I said earlier on, are modern, well equipped. Our science labs are very well appointed. The art spaces are on the top floor, so lots of light flooding in to enable art practitioners to make the most of the facility there. The music rooms and practice rooms down on the lower floors are fully soundproofed and available to practice between lessons. And we have a fantastic music tech space as well. Okay, and my last point really is our library, which is very well stocked with books and journals, has some great open access IT spaces, and also some smaller study rooms which students can book to work between their sessions. And we have an extensive range of e-books, as well as physical texts as well, and many journals for research and wider reading as well. So that's a little overview of our facilities and courses. And that brings me to the end of my part.
Thank you, Dominic. That was great. Thanks very much for that. Can you just, we've got a few questions from the audience.
Sure.
About the current obvious situation with teaching and, you know, COVID. How has that changed, you know, the teaching at the Angel campus?
Yeah, absolutely. That's a big challenge for all people involved in education. We adapted, I think, very, very well. All our classes carried on, so there was not one session class missed. We kept going with online provision using Google Classroom and Teams, which is a Microsoft product. And so our contact with students has been carrying on completely throughout the lockdown. When we come to August, it's obviously we're not entirely sure where we'll be at. If we are back on site, we have provision for that. Obviously, safeguarding, as I said earlier, is a paramount issue. It might be that we can have more blended learning, so some activity online, and then certainly the practical sessions can be on site, things like the sciences, performing arts, and art and textiles, where we do need physical space. Obviously, we are preparing for that now, and more detail will be available in the autumn.
That's great, Dominic. Thank you very much for that. Okay, thank you. So up next, we have Rebecca, who is in charge of media studies at the Angel campus. Hi, Rebecca. Welcome to today's event.
Hi, Val. I'm coming all the way from very rainy Hertfordshire. My broom cupboard of an office. Happy Saturday. Okay, so media studies. I'm Rebecca and I'm head of media studies at the Sixth Form Centre, and I'm going to do a very short spotlight on media for you. So if I can have the next slide, please.
Sure.
So let's talk through what you might do if you do media studies with us. Well, you'll do a lot. It's extremely varied, very, very relevant and current given what's going on in the world today. You'll see on screen examples of the sorts of things that we're going to do for your exams. It's 70% exam. Paper one has got an in-depth study on news, which again is very relevant. Daily Mail and The Guardian being the case studies there. And paper two looks at long form drama, Deutschland 83 and Stranger Things, which is always a hit with our students. And then several other range of sort of products and things that you'll study, including Minecraft, take you back to when you were a child, the Jungle Book and some music video. For your coursework, which is coming up on the next slide, you're going to make a music video and a website, and that makes up the 30% of the remaining A-level. And every year, the exam board will pre-release a brief with a new genre. Last year, it was pop. This year, fortuitously, it's protest songs. So my current year 12s are busy making music videos for protest songs and grabbing lots of footage from what's going on in the world at the moment. I've now got a video for you from one of last year's students. If we could play the video, that would be brilliant. Thank you. That would be great. So the students make a music video and they make a website, and it's their remaining 30% of their course, and they do it all on their own. So it's a great test for when you get into the music industry. Is it possible to see the website, Val?
Yeah, absolutely.
If it isn't, don't worry, go on to the next slide.
We'll just get it started.
So suspense coming all the way from Hertfordshire at the end of the Metropolitan line. It takes a while to get to London, doesn't it?
Radio.
Oh, that's okay. Wrong.
I really liked learning about the history on video games. And
one of my students talking about how brilliant the course is. Not what I thought was coming up.
The media department would definitely have to be the access to the equipment, as learning about and using the right tools can really help bring your ideas and creativity to life, making them the best they can be. Another thing would be the support from the teachers, as they really guide you patiently throughout the entire course so that you can get to where you want to be.
Studying media at the Sixth Form College is very fun, and it's also very current because things in the media are constantly changing, as we can see now. And also things that you do in your everyday life, like the TV shows you watch, what you read, you can apply that to your lessons. I enjoyed studying the news in year 12 and looking at the theories about those, because of you get to see the effect that has on people and as a society, and how that sort of changes the way that we might think about people or about events. I think one of the best things about the media department is how supportive the teachers are. They really take the time to explain everything to you, even if you don't get it the first time round. They'll use different examples, or they'll change the way they're explaining it. I also think that the equipment is very good, and learning how to use that is quite fun as well.
Studying media at college is very fun, because you don't only stick to one certain thing.
If we could stop that, Tom, because we're thinking about a wide range. Thank you. If we could go back to the slides, that would be great.
Thank you.
I wasn't expecting to see those videos. It is nice to see my students, though. If we could go back to the slide, the next slide, which is what we'll also study, talks about theory. Thank you. Right. OK, so one of the really important things about media studies is the theory that underpins it. So there are 19 compulsory theorists, but don't let that scare you. But there's really relevant theory that we study in media. So we look at Paul Gilroy, bell hooks, Stuart Hall, Curran and Seaton. And obviously, we also look at the theoretical framework of media studies, which is language, representation, audience and industries. So I think if we just go to the last slide now, that'd be lovely. So why study with us? Obviously, brilliant equipment, brilliant teachers, fantastic links with industry and HE. We are fully integrated into Google Classroom to make online learning seamless. And you will be supported by two absolutely brilliant technicians. OK, and if you want to keep in touch with us, then we've got our Twitter and our Instagram coming up on the next slide. Or maybe we haven't. OK.
Actually use the main college Twitter and Instagram, if you know that's fully visible for your area as well. Rebecca, we've got a few questions from the audience. I know in your presentation you touched upon the balance between exam and the practical side of media studies. So the percentage you mentioned is what, 70-30. How intense is the practical side and the theory side? How does a student balance that?
The practical work, well, the most of the first year is going to be theory work, and the practical doesn't start until three quarters of the way through year one because of the pre-release brief. So we get quite a lot of the exam content done in the first year, and then we have a nice lead in to the practical work, and that lasts for about 4 months. And then we then go into revision for the exam. So it's a really nice, even balance, not overwhelming at all. Our students quite like the structure that we've set up for them.
Sure. And the, like you mentioned, the employers, are they all locally based or do you get to travel much? How does that work?
Mostly because of the nature of the media industry, most of it is local in London. So we've got some links with the film company just down the road in Islington. So we try where possible to make links with local firms. And some of the students will go slightly further afield, but on the whole, it tends to be London.
That's fantastic. Thank you very much, Rebecca. That was great. And sorry about the hiccups.
Don't worry.
Thank you. Okay, next up we have Sean Allen, who is the head tutor for social sciences in A-levels at the Angel campus. Hi, Sean. How are you today?
I'm good, thanks. How are you?
Very well, thank you. Thanks for coming on board.
Great. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to give you a little overview of social sciences at the Sixth Form Centre, and then I'm going to go through each of the three subjects that fall under the umbrella of social sciences. So for some of you who don't know anything about social sciences, what these three subjects are interested in looking at, and those subjects are A-level psychology, A-level sociology and A-level geography. All three of them are interested in looking at the workings of humans and societies. So the students absolutely love studying these three subjects because, number one, they draw on their own lived experiences, but also they look at really important contemporary issues such as climate change, mental illness, and also social inequality. So right now, this is a really exciting time to be studying a social science subject. So all three of these A-levels do equip students with the scientific skills and expertise needed to conduct research, to look at things critically, and to explore a number of social science concepts and theories. So what I'm going to do is I am going to just take each one of these A-level subjects and give you a little flavour of some of the questions that we might ask students to think about. So we've got sociology up here at the moment. I'm assuming you can all see this. And just in the top left, we've got a picture of George Floyd. So obviously at the moment, everybody is talking about Black Lives Matter. And the students at the moment that we are teaching, they are exploring some of the issues around ethnicity, social inequality, and the ways in which the media represent these different stories and the extent to which society is structured in a way that subjugates and oppresses ethnic minorities. So it is such a fascinating subject for students to be studying at the moment. So one of the questions that we ask throughout the two-year course is, you know, to what extent is social class, gender or ethnicity a factor that affects your life chances? We look at the fact that although statistics suggest that men overwhelmingly commit more crimes than women, you know, why is that? Or is it a case of perhaps those statistics around women and crime are just underrepresented and are hidden? Obviously, we look at the family and whether or not the kind of nuclear family, you know, mum, dad and two children is a thing of the past. And what might have brought about these changes to the family in contemporary society. And a big part of sociology is looking at religion, the extent to which it creates harmony or conflict in societies. Absolutely fascinating subject. I would say this because it is my subject specialism and I could talk about it all day long. And then if we move on to the next subject, you can see here geography. Again, obviously, many students will think of geography as something that is about physical geography, and that does play, you know, is a big part of the syllabus. But another part of the syllabus is looking at social geography, so things around superpowers, globalization, the regeneration of cities, absolutely fascinating subject. And of course, students will be expected to conduct field work. And so again, they are going to be equipped with scientific skills in which to analyze, you know, a whole range of different types of data. So you can see some of the questions that we might ask in geography. So should the USA be a global police on human rights? How much of Britain will be lost to the sea? You can see a picture in the bottom right hand corner of a house that's fallen into the sea. So, you know, we look at erosion in geography and the rise of extremism related to the failure of globalization. That is a question we also ask in sociology. And many of our students do study sociology and geography, or sociology and psychology. So if we have a look at the psychology slide, and you'll be able to see a little bit of overlap with sociology and with psychology. Sure.
Sean, just bear with us.
Okay, no problem.
Sure.
So with psychology, we do ask about social change, this idea that societies and individuals, you know, they don't stay the same. We are constantly changing. Again, here we go. Why do people commit crime? So psychology is different to sociology in the sense that it looks at the individual and looks at kind of individual biological processes, for example, whereas sociology is much more interested in social factors. So one of the other questions is, how do attachments form? And that's to do with, you know, the relationships that we have when we are growing up within the family. What ways do we learn? How do we develop phobias, for example? Why is it that people might be afraid of spiders, or why might people be afraid of flying? And why do we obey orders to kill? So it's controversial. It's very exciting and fascinating. And of course, the skills that you're going to acquire in studying sociology, geography and psychology will be useful for a whole range of different progression routes. So I will say that the vast majority of our students, they do go on to university. Some of them go on to an apprenticeship or employment. But in fact, psychology is the most popular degree that our students at City and Islington Sixth Form go on to study. If they're not studying psychology, then they may often go on and study criminology. That's super popular. And also we are introducing level 3 criminology in September, which falls under the social science department. If you're interested in studying A-level geography, many of the students who study that at A-level will go on to university and study either geography, environmental sciences, international development, law. But yes, the vast majority of students do go on to higher education. If I can just talk through some of the grade entry requirements for the majority of our A-levels at City and Islington Sixth Form, you've got to achieve your minimum 5 GCSEs at a 4 to 9 plus a minimum 5 in English language. We also ask that you have a 6 in a written subject. So that could be English language, or it could be English Lit, or it could be geography, RS. Sociology doesn't require the higher maths and science entry requirements, but geography and psychology do. So you do need to have a minimum 5 in GCSE maths, and also a 5 in one of your sciences, or in the case of geography, if you studied geography at GCSE, we ask that you've achieved a 5 at GCSE geography. So that is social sciences in a nutshell, and it's over to the Q&A now, I guess.
Thank you, Sean. That's great. That was really informative. I've got a couple of questions here from various students and people in the audience. They're talking about the textbooks that are mainly used in sociology and psychology. Are you able to just elaborate on that or specify exactly what textbooks are used?
Yes, absolutely. So we have some core textbooks that we make available to all students in the classroom. We also have an incredible library where students can take the books out themselves, but we all also will issue students with their own textbook that they can keep at home. That's not something that they have to pay for. We will provide that for them. So in sociology, we use mainly the A-level sociology textbook by Webb, Westergaard and Trobe. It's got an orange cover, so if any of you are keen to have a little look online, just type into Amazon A-level sociology. It's the most popular textbook nationwide, and it's got an orange cover. You cannot miss it. It's super accessible, and it's designed by the people who actually help write the sociology exams. And it's very portable, so you can put it in your bag and you can take it to and from college. And it's got so many brilliant activities in there, lots of quizzes and questions. It's a really accessible textbook. And then in the case of psychology, they use the Green-Haired Girl book. So again, if you type it into Amazon, you'll be able to see it there, or any other reputable textbook suppliers. Sure. And again, it's the same situation, the same setup in geography and psychology. We have a full set of classroom textbooks. We have them in the library, and we'll also issue students with those textbooks so that they have them at home.
Great, that's very good. Thank you so much. Well, I've got a few questions on about the class sizes in the social sciences. Can you just estimate roughly how many you anticipate, or in the previous years, you know, in sociology and psychology especially?
Sure. Well, unlike school, where I think you'll probably have about 30 students in your class, we do have much smaller class sizes. They are very, very popular subjects, particularly psychology and sociology, but we have a max number of 22. So we never ever go over that. And so if you think about it, you're going to have quite a lot more opportunities for one-to-one contact with your teacher, smaller group work opportunities. So it's not like school. You're definitely going to feel it's a little bit more intimate there. Okay.
Well, that's great. And I've got, this is quite specific, actually. I'm not sure if you'd be able to answer, but I've got a student here who wants to go into studying law. Would those social sciences help them go into that profession or that area of study, or would you suggest something else?
No, they are brilliant subjects to go on and study law. In fact, psychology is our most popular degree that students go on to study, closely followed by law. And the vast majority of students either study sociology or psychology, sometimes with politics, for example. But yes, it's a great, you know, those two subjects in particular, and also geography to some extent. But certainly sociology and psychology are fantastic subjects that are really good facilitating subjects that enable you to go on and study law at university.
Thank you so much, Sean. That's great. That's been really informative. Okay, thanks. Thanks for joining us. Next up, we have Spencer Wood, who is a lecturer at the Angel Campus in Performing and Visual Arts. Hi, Spencer. Welcome to today's.
Hello. Hi. Thank you.
Good.
It's exciting to kind of talk to so many people about our subject. So it's good to have people on board.
Brilliant. Off you go.
Okay, so my name is Spencer. I am the coordinator for performing and visual arts at the sixth form centre, so all those A levels. So we have 9 subjects within our department. I'm just going to talk you briefly through those. Because there's 9, I don't have time to go into all of them in depth. So there is more information on the website about each one. So I'm just going to break them down into their kind of constituent parts a bit. So in our visual arts department, we have 5 subjects. That is critical and contextual studies, fine art, graphic communications, photography, and textiles. Now, the one that you might not be very familiar with in that list is critical and contextual studies. We are the only sixth form centre that runs this A-level, and it's a little bit like history of art. You look at installations, you look at kind of the journey of art modes and styles, and it's a very interesting course, and it's a fantastic course to take alongside other art subjects. And then fine art, graphics, you probably know what those are a little bit, photography and textiles. So those are our 5 visual art subjects. And then in the performing arts, we have music, we have dance, we have drama and theatre, and we have music technology. So we are a very big cohort for performing and visual arts in London, and we do offer subjects that not many other places offer. If you want to know a little bit more about each one of those A levels, then please do go on the website, have a look through the individual courses. As I said, we're a large department. We have subjects you can't take anywhere else, and the beauty of City in Islington is that you can combine these subjects with any other subject in the college. that often doesn't happen at schools because we know there is a limited offer of performing and visual art. So you could either take drama and or art, but here you could take both. And in fact, majority of our students do end up taking more than one. So we have students that do drama and dance, or drama and art, or students that do all three. So we've got loads of students that do textiles, photography, and critical and contextual studies. So they come in knowing that what they want to do in the creative industry and have created an arts package for themselves like that. So we're really lucky to offer this really broad range. Again, our facilities are fantastic. We have a whole floor of the building dedicated to the visual arts alone. We have a newly established dark room where you can develop photography. We have a workspace. We have huge studio classrooms. We have two visual arts technicians and we have two performing arts technicians that work in our spaces to support students. We have industry standard resources available and also loads of connections with HE, which I'll talk about a bit later on. So we have fantastic department of performing visual arts. Now, just a bit of the makeup of the courses themselves. So the visual arts courses, they have two components. One is the personal investigation, and that's worth 60% of the qualification. Now, this is kind of what people understand for the coursework of the visual art courses. You set up alongside your teachers something that you want to investigate, an idea, a theme, a concept, and then you go about kind of in your own discipline, whether that's fine art, graphics, photography, exploring that in a practical way, and you produce an outcome. And then 40% of the qualification is the externally set assignment. So the exam board set an assignment, and then you work towards that assignment and you complete it over 3 days in a 15-hour practical exam. So there's a real balance between practical work and preparatory and theoretical work. So it's not all practical. There is some theory that backs up all the practical work that you do, but there are no written exams in visual arts. Then the performing arts. So each subject in the performing arts varies, but between 50 and 60% of it is coursework and performance. So we have a balance again of both theory and practical work in the performing arts subjects, but all four of the performing arts subjects have a written exam at the end of the second year. So there is a written element to those courses. So again, have a look on the website if you want to know a little bit more about the balance between the performing arts courses, written work and practical work. So next slide, please. And this is just some of the people that we work with as a performing and visual arts department, but visual arts specifically. So we have some great links and connections with higher institutions. So UAL come in and work with our students, and a lot of our students go on to UAL. We work with investment bankers Macquarie and also the law firm Charles Russell Speechley, and every year they do a competition with our students in which students get cash prizes and also their work exhibited in those places in the city. So it's really exciting, and they hold these big events and we go and there's canapes and drinks. It's really fun, but it also goes, look, this is what it's like to be an artist in some areas. And then if we go on to the next slide, these are some of our links with the performing arts department. So we have really strong links with the Armada Theatre, which is in Islington. It's just up the road. They come and deliver workshops for our students. We go and see a lot of their shows for the drama students. For the dance students, we're right next door to the premier dance venue in the country, Sadler's Wells. So it takes 2 minutes from our building, and we go there with our students a lot. And again, we get workshops. Our students this year were in a curtain raiser for Matthew Bourne. So they get to perform just before Matthew Bourne's company, and then they kind of get workshops with them. It's some fantastic work. And for music and music tech students, they work with the Claude Ensemble, who come in and work on their compositions. And also they go down to the Tile Yard Studios to see what it's like to be a recording artist, but also a producer. So it's some really exciting links we have with people around London. On the next slide, if we can just go to that one.
Yeah, sure. Just bear with us, Spencer.
Okay. What I can just talk about is some general questions that some people have about the courses.
Yeah. So we have questions about the social distancing, okay, especially with dance practicals.
Yes.
Or the practical elements. Are you able to cover that at all? How
yeah,
you...
I, suppose I can tell you a bit about what we know at the moment. We're waiting for the exam boards to make an official statement about those. But the majority of the courses do have elements in which can be completed socially distanced. So since going into lockdown, we have been carrying on all our lessons online, and we've been doing face-to-face work, we've been doing monologues, people have been recorded, they've had some work set up to do some practical work at home where they could. So yeah, lots of things still going on socially distanced. Now we're waiting, as I said, to hear a little bit more about performing arts courses to see what the exam board say, if they're changing anything. But for the moment, we're going ahead as normal, and there are only a couple of elements that we can't complete.
Okay. Now have a video for your area, I believe.
Yeah, so this video, if I can just kind of explain what it is. So every year we do a huge college production, and that takes in students from across the sixth form. So you don't have to be doing a performing or visual arts subject in order to take part in this. It's a fantastic event. We perform over 3 nights, but 5 shows. We do some shows during the day as well, some matinees, and we end up performing to about 800 to 1,000 people. And we've got a huge cast. You can be the crew, dancers, band. We have a live band that are all students. So this is just a really short clip from our production this year, which we managed to get done in December, of Chicago, which is the fan favorite is Cell Block Tango. So just a couple of minutes of this.
From the video, the level that the students are working on is pretty phenomenal.
Yeah, I mean,
what setting and the ambience of the whole stage is fantastic.
Yeah, what we expect is like industry standard from our students, really, whether that's extracurricular like Chicago or the actual courses themselves. So all that was designed, the set was designed by students, the lighting design was created and led by students, costume design, everything. So we're just there to facilitate and guide it. So some fantastic work. And again, if you ever get a chance to come and see any of our performances, if you're a student outside of performing visual arts, please do. Our students would love to see that. So if there are any questions, I can take those.
Yeah, absolutely. We have some eager students actually looking to join the course. So is there an opportunity to join bands or groups within once they join the course?
So our main band is for the production that we do each year. So the enrichment is for the college production. So that's the main band, really. So you audition for that band. However, having said that, our music and music tech students, once they get onto the courses and they get to know each other, they often form bands because they like to play music together and they like to do those things.
Sure.
We have one at the moment, actually. So our alumni have got a recording deal and they're working together and they met on the course. They're all musicians on the course. They're fantastic. And they've got some music out at the moment. It's on our website. So go and have a look at that.
Great. OK. And if you actually don't study music or parts of performing arts or visual arts, do other students who join, maybe the medical the more science subjects based, do they have opportunity to use your facilities as well?
So our facilities are predominantly for the performing arts students and the visual arts students. However, if they get involved in an enrichment, then they can use the facilities related to that. But we have to keep a little bit of a hold over those because we have so many students within our department. So for example, we have just under 100 drama students currently, and if we were to let other students use those spaces as well, our students wouldn't be able to. So there is some room for engagement, especially if you do the sixth form talent show. They often use our spaces and equipment to rehearse. And just one thing as well, if you haven't done a visual art or a performing arts subject at DCSE, but you want to take them at A level, then there is opportunity to do that. For visual arts, we ask for a portfolio, and there will be guidance on the website and what to include in the portfolio if you haven't done that subject, so which to show and teach that enrollment. And for music tech, music and dance, there is a short audition for entry onto the course, but not onto drama, so don't worry, but on you have to have the GCSE in drama or extensive experience elsewhere. So you can get onto those courses if you haven't taken them at GCSE, just kind of seek some of the guidance that's online.
Sure, that's great. Thank you very much, Spencer.
Okay.
That's really good and very important.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for addressing.
Have a nice day.
As well. You too, thank you.
All right, bye-bye. Okay.
Thanks. Next up, we have Philippa Cook, who is from our Careers and Employability team. She will be followed by Jo Bishop as well. Hi, Philip. Philippa, how are you?
Hi there, I'm good, yes.
Great, okay.
So I'll go ahead. So hi everybody, as Bao said, my name is Philippa Cook and I cover careers, but I will also support you when you come to college on a wider area around student services as well. But today I'm going to talk to you about careers. So why see a careers advisor? We are here to help you to look for a career, not just the careers we already know about, such as an engineer or a doctor, but also to prepare for future careers that do not exist yet, such as drone traffic controller. So career pathways can be unclear, especially if you don't know what you're looking for or where. So we're here to help you shine a light on your different options and different pathways that are available to you. So this means that our advice is relevant and current, which responds to labour market information published yearly by the government. This means that jobs that we know that are shortages are promoted by the government, so we can help and guide you so that you can make your choices. We provide resources, newsletters, and how to access up-to-date news in the industry you want to go into. So it's really important that we encourage you to read so you feel confident when you're writing, for example, your personal statement to university, or if you're going for an interview, a university interview, an apprenticeship interview, you will feel confident about talking about your career area. A large part of our work is around helping you to apply to university, so we have a very good university support service. So all students have to see an advisor when they apply. We support you in and out of a classroom to research your careers and options, but also really importantly, your teachers throughout your course will be highlighting career opportunities within your lessons, which then we can explore face-to-face and online. So it's really helpful that teachers are able to point out careers whilst you're learning that you may not know that existed. So we will make informed choices on your future career. We will help you at all stages before and after you're sending your application form. So even once you've sent it, the support doesn't end there. We'll help you with your choices. We will help you deciding which one you want to go through, your the entry grades, and how you would actually accept them and prepare for it. As mentioned before, work experience is really, really important, whether it be helping out at college on open days, but also going out into the industry, doing things that you want to do connected to it. So we really encourage you to gain work experience. Some courses on the applied science side are compulsory and part of your timetable. So particularly people doing health studies and wanting to go into things like nursing, we will be looking at getting relevant work experience to support that. This is also important because the more exposure to the world of work you have, the higher earnings you are likely to receive in the future. One of the most valuable things that you can get whilst you're having work experience is a reference that you're then able to put on future applications. So what we're going to see now is a video from one of our students who went on a work experience at St Patrick's Pancras Hospital.
Hi, my name is Jada and I go to City of Islington College. I do Level 3 Health Sciences and I'm going to be talking about how I got accepted into a nursing apprenticeship. So I really wanted to do nursing since I started the course, and my course was based on health and sciences, and I knew I enjoyed doing those subjects a lot. So I wanted to get into a nursing apprenticeship, and I went to the careers advisors and I asked her if there is any possible way of getting into a nursing apprenticeship, because it's really hard to find a nursing apprenticeship. So they told me if I went and done a work experience, which there was at the time in St Pancras Hospital, they told me it would be if I asked them if I could do an apprenticeship. And yeah, so I went and I done my work experience, and I also asked them if I could get into an apprenticeship with them. And they said they're going to have to see how my work experience goes and they will let me know. So I went to work every single day. I made sure I was on time. I was positive. I loved it, like, which I really did enjoy going, and I did love it a lot. And then the staff there was amazing, and I just loved helping people out. So at the end of my work experience, they emailed me and they said that they do want me to go there and do an apprenticeship with them, and I accepted this offer. They also said I'm going to be going to university 2 times a week, which is going to help me get a degree at the end of the apprenticeship that I'm going to be doing. So I'm going to be starting this apprenticeship in September, and I'm really looking forward for this apprenticeship. And this apprenticeship is going to take 4 years because I'm going to be going university and I'm going to be doing going work at the same time. And I'm thankful for all the teachers and the careers advisors that helped me out in City of Islington College, because without them I would have not got into this apprenticeship. So I'm really thankful.
Hi, my name is Jada and I go to City of
So she was very, very happy, and it's really turned out into a great success story, as it does for, I can quickly give you some figures. So last year's of students who were eligible to apply to university, I think something like 96% went, and we're easily looking at those sort of numbers again of people being successful going to university. And an enormous amount of them are very, very successful at going to their first choice university.
Great. Philippa, we've got a few people in the audience who are just concerned about, so obviously the change in the exams, the grading, etc. What would be your advice to them? Because some of them have got conditional offers already. So around enrolment, what would be the best advice you could give them?
I think that around enrolment, whatever your results are, still come and attend the enrolment, and we would have a look at what your grades are. I mean, let's be positive. Hopefully everybody's going to get their predicted grade. But yes, if for any reason you didn't, we will always find you something to do. And even if it means doing a slight swap, we will always get you onto a course that will then eventually lead to where you want to go. We would never let anyone leave empty handed.
That's great to know. So that it's quite reassuring to know that any students coming to enrolment, you're able to give them that advice and guidance.
Absolutely.
And if they need to change their course, they can do so.
Yeah, and we have different levels, so we will find a way in which we'll be able to fit them onto their pathway that they want to go on and continue on their journey to be whatever it was that they wanted to at university. We're very good at doing that.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Philippa. Okay, we now have Joanne Bishop, who will be talking about careers and enrichment at the Angel Campus. Hi, Jo. How are you today?
Hi, I'm fine, thank you. You?
I'm very well, thanks.
Good. Okay, I'll get started. So, yeah, I'm super excited to tell you about the amazing opportunities we have for students at the Angel Campus. There's not enough time to literally go through everything, but you can have a look at our careers programmes on our website, and that gives you a much more comprehensive idea of what the opportunities are. So students join us at different stages, really, of their career planning. So some students join us with a very, very clear idea of what they want to do. They know what job they want to do. They know what degree they want to do. But others join us with perhaps who are perhaps a little bit more unsure and want to use their time at college to explore different careers and gain experience, which is absolutely fine. You're not expected to know exactly what job you want to do when you start on your college programme. So that's why we're here. So we want to give you every opportunity to take part in enrichment and opportunities so you can really develop those career plans. So we look at all the different options available to you. So some students go on to university, some students go on to apprenticeships, and some students choose to take gap years. What's a really fantastic development this year is that students, when they join us, will actually choose a career pathway. So this is brilliant for us because it means that we can really tailor enrichment and link it to the different career sectors. So sometimes students try out careers through work experience, like the student that Philippa just showed the video of. This is a fantastic way, really, of developing your career plan. I mean, I think good career planning is often a case of sort of a process of elimination, really. Just working out what you don't want to do is a good way to sort of further your plans. So we hope your time with us, we can give you opportunities to develop the skills that we know that employers and universities are really looking for. So next slide, please. So all students, when they join us, they'll follow a structured tutorial programme. And within the tutorial programme, you're guided through all the key decisions you've got to make during your time at college, which might seem overwhelming at first when you have to decide which university you're going to go to, whether you want to do an apprenticeship. But that's, as I said before, that's why we're here. So we have a full programme of careers talks that will really cover a wide range of topics. So we'll talk to you about how to research universities, how to research apprenticeships, how to build your CV, how to strengthen your university application, and how to do things like write your personal statement and how to write for student finance. So some of these, you know, at first might seem like a bit overwhelming, but that's why we're here. So throughout the tutorial programme, we try to involve employers and universities who come into the workshops to pass on their really valuable insight and advice. The programme really focuses on student needs, and an example of this is that the last few years we've had an opportunity for year 13 students to join specialist tutor groups. So students who know they want to do an apprenticeship when they leave us rather than go to university, we have our future apprentice group. And within that, students work really closely with employers, largely Lloyds Banking Group, which we have a fantastic partnership with. And within those workshops, they take them through the typical recruitment process for an apprenticeship. Also, if you're heading for an art and design course, you can join a VAD tutor group. So employer partnerships, as I've mentioned, we've got an impressive talks programme, which is really fantastic for students to gain more information about different careers that they're interested in. So students have many opportunities to meet employers. This year, we've welcomed lawyers, doctors, actors, writers, entrepreneurs, social workers, engineers. I mean, the list could just go on. So speakers share their career journeys and they offer tips and advice about gaining relevant work experience. And they provide essential insight into what employers are looking for in terms of skills and experience. So we've got some really great enrichment programmes. So where students are able to work with mentors from industry. Arts Emergency is an absolutely brilliant scheme where this is aimed at students who are aiming for more creative careers. And they're matched with mentors who might be actors, musicians, artists. Another example, we had a fantastic partnership this year where we were able to start a course for students who are interested in TV production. So this was the local TV production company, and the students were able to submit their ideas for documentaries and then receive feedback from, you know, those working in the industry. Other students worked with journalists to improve their writing skills. MedicLink has been mentioned before, so any aspiring doctors out there, this is a fantastic program where you'll get to follow sessions with UCL second year students. So they'll come in and they do workshops with you about so you can learn more about the medical profession. We have ex-students that offer various sessions about kind of how to prepare for tests that you'll have to do if you decide to apply for medicine, how to write a really good personal statement. Civil service is the other thing mentioned on the slide. So we've got a fantastic partnership with the civil service, and over recent weeks they've been mentoring students, they've been offering work experience with students. So these links with the employers just literally grow every year. So yeah, brilliant opportunities. And legal action, I'll just mention that one as well. So any aspiring lawyers out there, we have a fantastic program where they can hear from barristers and solicitors. They get to debate various kind of legal issues, and most students on those programs will get work experience with a leading law firm. We have several law firms that we work very closely with: Slaughter and May, Charles Oswald Speechleys, Norton Rose Fulbright. Students can also access scholarships which will support them through university. So we've got two brilliant students this year who actually have a scholarship with Herbert Smith Freehills that will support them throughout university. Lloyds Banking Group, as I've mentioned, I'll just mention this briefly. So Lloyds Banking Group, we've developed our Lloyds Junior Scholars Program, which is unique to Candy. So students work with those working in banking and finance, and they're sort of taken through employability workshops, really. So they help them prepare for interview, how to write a really decent CV. And at the end of a program, they get the certificate, and some are selected to do work experience.
That's great, Jo.
So at the university partnerships, I'll just very briefly mention those. So university links, students get to go on various campus visits to partner universities. These are great to get, so students can then decide whether or not they want to stay at home or go away to university. We have academic tutoring programs. So we work with LSE. So students work with LSE undergraduates who will help them with their current studies. And obviously, through partnerships, we get access to various scholarships and access schemes, which can really guide them through the process. So finally, next slide. We have our scholars program, which may as well have been mentioned before. So if you're a student that's aiming high and want to apply for a competitive university course, so particularly if you're aiming for Oxford or Cambridge, we've got a brilliant support system in place where we will prepare you for those applications. So if you're going to join us in year 12 and that's where you're heading, you can join our scholars program if you meet the entry requirements, and you'll have visits to Oxford and Cambridge. We have academic skills workshops, interview practice, where we involve our employer partners and STEM ambassadors, and we will make sure that you do enrichment that's really going to help you with your application. So I hope that gives you a bit of an idea of what we have. As I say, it's impossible to go through everything. We have got a little video now where you'll get a chance to hear from some of our brilliant students who have taken part in some of these activities.
Hi, I'm Dominic Brown. I attend Arts Emergency in year 12 and Curb Media in year 13. Arts Emergency is a mentoring charity that provides young people with networked and work experience in higher education, creative and cultural industries. It provided me with my mentor, Edward Barlow, who is a TV producer. He helped show me what a film and television industry career would look like by helping me develop new skills such as screenwriting, making sure I was focused on my studies in film and media studies. Curve Media, Curve Foundation was an opportunity to work on pitch, on a TV pitch. Its company offered the students an opportunity to develop an idea and turn it into a television pitch through its numerous processes, and allowed us to visit their building so to see what a real studio production studio would look like.
It was a really fun experience because it taught us a lot about the fashion industry and how the process goes from designing to creating to photographing to promoting. We also got to have a really hands-on experience and get really creative as we were given the opportunity to make our own jewellery as well as our own clothes using tie-dye and printing techniques, which I found really fun because it gave us opportunity to get our own ideas out there and get involved in a really practical way. We were also given the chance to create our own promotion material for the brand through videos or photography if we wanted to. And on the final day, we were all involved in a photo shoot using the pieces we created as well as actual pieces from the collection. So it was a really fun way to actually learn about how working for a fashion brand works, because it got us involved instead of just talking to us.
Jo, that's great. It's full of loads of different opportunities like you've just spoken about. I've got a question in from the audience about, I know you mentioned the MediLink you work with, but if a student wants to go down the medical route, which hospitals and medical universities do you work with? Can you just specify them again or just go into a bit more detail?
Yeah, I mean, the MediLink programme is just a really great support enrichment group for those students. So, we work with UCL, so the UCL second year undergraduates come in and talk to the students. The actual enrichment is run by the science department, so they'll have particular hospitals that they do work with. But the whole point of our programme is also to encourage students to kind of put themselves forward. So we've got a whole list of contacts that we can provide students who want to make speculative applications about work experience. So we prepare them for that. But it doesn't have to be in a hospital. We know from our knowledge of admissions processes that a lot of medical courses would like to see a broader range of work experience, whether that's helping out in a care home, in a holiday play scheme. So we can advise on that.
Great. Okay. And I've got a question here about personal statements. Obviously, someone's going through the process right now. So when would they start the statement, and what advice would you give them?
So that's all built into our tutorial program. So we have a fantastic online program called OSCAR, actually, that we register all students on. And it takes students through the whole process of writing a personal statement, giving them advice on wider reading, etc., to strengthen it. So our current year 12s will have started working on that now. So we start talking to students about research in university very early on, so in the January of year 12. And then the actual personal statement writing starts in that summer term, so that when they come back to us in year 13, they're almost ready to go. So we have early deadlines to encourage students to meet.
Great. So all in all, whether it's work experience, CV workshops, personal statements, all the support is on site from you and your team.
Yeah, it's really thorough, and I would really advise, if you can, have a look at the full careers programmes for both the Centre for Applied Sciences and the Sixth Form Centre, which are on the website, because that gives you a really good idea of what support's around.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Jo. That's been
pleasure.
Great. Okay, have a great day.
Thank you.
Bye. Okay, up next we have application and our pathway programme. So the application process will be by Matt, who's the Deputy Director at the Angel Campus. Hi Matt, how are you today?
I'm good. Hi Val, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you. Off you go.
So hi everyone. My name is Matt Wojtyniak. I'm one of the deputy directors at the Angel Campus. I'll be briefly talking you through the process of applying for our courses. So first of all, the main place to make applications is on the website. Everything is on the website and all the information about the courses, the most up-to-date source of information is the website. So once you need to go to candy.ac.uk, and once you find the courses that you're interested in, you can read about all the information there. This applies to both the A levels and the all the vocational routes. You can find the course and the information there. So you can search for them and read about them and research them. It's a very, very useful resource. Once you find a course, you will have, as you can see, sort of bits of information there that talk you through all the different elements and bit piece of information that you need. So first of all, some general information about the course, followed by a very detailed bit about what you will actually study, what you will be learning, what skills you'll be developing while you're on the courses. The next thing is the bit of information that's really important, I suppose, is what are the entry criteria for the course. So all the entry criteria for all of our A levels and for the vocational courses are on the page as well. You can see what are the grades that you need to have to be able to apply and to be processed. The next part is very interesting and very, I think, for a lot of students, quite useful also is about the assessment process. So how will I be assessed? Whether it is an exam-based assessment process or is it portfolio? That is very useful information to find out and to know and to have that information when applying for courses. Extremely importantly, the final bit, but it's probably the most important, is what does this course lead you to after you do it with us? What is the progression? So that part on the course website where it talks about what can I do after I finish the course. Please read those in great detail. That is very important and tells you through what you can progress to and what things you can achieve after you study with us. All of our applications are done online. So if you find the information that you need and you understand exactly what you want and you meet the entry criteria, you can apply for these courses and we do that fully online. So once you complete the online application form and you sort of choose the courses and then make the applications, we will then be in touch with you to arrange the following steps. You create, when applying online, you create your own account so you can track your application and what the outcome is. So following an online interview, for example, if you receive an offer, that will all be, all that information will be in that, in your account. Practical piece of information, but very important, I suppose, always, is you are able to reset your password. This happens, obviously, and we will then send you an email which talks you through how to reset that password. Importantly, first of all, when we send you that email, there is a 1 hour window to do that. It's live for 1 hour to reset your password. And if you can't see that email somehow in your main inbox, please check in your spam folder. It's a no reply type of email, so sometimes they end up in the spam folder. So that was all I have about the applications and that you have to make online. And I'll pass back on to you, Bao.
Thank you very much, Matt. That's great. So next we have Brian Johnson, who will be talking about our pathway program at the Angel Campus. Hi, Brian.
Hi, Bao. Thank you. Hi, everybody. My name is Brian Johnston, and as Bao says, I am a Deputy Director at the Angel Campus, and I'm going to be talking to you this afternoon about pathways that we have designed for you. So at the Angel Campus, we have carefully designed a number of career pathways to help our applicants make informed decisions about their course choices. Although you might just be starting your journey with us at City in Islington, the pathways will help you think about your next steps after A-level or vocational study. We have two overarching themes with our pathway model. So we have a STEAM pathway, where subjects relate to science and technology, and we also have a humanities and arts pathway. Each of these areas has five pathways within them, and each discusses where the pathway might lead to, and it provides you with a number of subjects and activity that would be suitable. Okay. Within these pathways, there are a number of subjects that are mandatory for you to follow, and these will be indicated within the pathway models that you'll get to see. Each pathway also includes tutorials. So a number of my colleagues today have talked about the tutorial program that we offer at the campus. Similar to secondary school, you'll have a form tutor who's your first point of contact here at the campus, and they work with you throughout your study to track your progress. The pathway also identifies enrichment activities which will be suitable to that particular curriculum area. So I want to talk to you a little bit more about how these might work. So my colleague Jo earlier talked about a medical pathway. We have lots of students really interested in pursuing a career in medicine or dentistry or medical science. And here within the pathway, we know that A-level biology and chemistry are mandatory subjects. We know that this is what universities are expecting to see from applicants. So we advise you to take those courses. Your third A-level can be chosen from a list of subjects that we presented to you within the pathway. And your third choice will be dependent on your interests, but also possibly the requirements of a university that you've already expressed an interest in. We know when we've met students previously face to face that whilst you're thinking about college now, some of you are already thinking about university. If you're unsure what that third A-level choice might be, please don't worry. There's still lots of advice and guidance available to you at enrolment, but also you can reach out to us via our website as well, and somebody can be in touch with you whilst you're making your application. So as I've already mentioned, you have tutorial and enrichment as part of your programme. And within that pathway, you might be participating in our Medic Link Society, again another activity that my colleague Joe mentioned earlier on. We have a fantastic chemistry club, or there might be opportunities for academic mentoring to take place. So there's a real range of suitable activities within each pathway, and we really pride ourselves on our enrichment offer at the campus. If you're thinking about options outside of A-level, you might be exploring a vocational route, then there are often vocational pathways and options available to you as well. So, for example, within the medical pathway, we do have a level 3 applied science extended diploma, which could be followed within that pathway. And you would obviously have access to all of those activities that I've mentioned to you. I have focused quite heavily on the medical pathway this morning, but that is just one example I wanted to share with you today. We do have 9 other pathways, which include engineering, it includes sports, performing arts, and the creative industries, and there are more than what I've mentioned here today. These are here to help you make informed choices about your courses and to ensure that you can hit the ground running with us in September when you start to study with us. So our pathway models will be available to you on our website, and they will be sent out to all applicants. If you're viewing us today and you've already made an application and you're just kind of intrigued and you want to learn more about the campus, we will be sending this out to you as well, so our pathway models. And what we would like you to do over the summer is to review the courses that you've already applied for and that you may have already accepted offers on. We want you to really think about, are you confident that you've made the right choices? Are your choices in line with where you see yourself going after your time at the college? And if not, there is still time to receive further advice and guidance and to make some adjustments. It's really important that you are on the right courses in September, and as I said, you can hit the ground running. So that is about our pathway model that we have here at the Angel campus. And I just want to pick up a little bit more about entry requirements, which my colleague Matt spoke about a moment ago. So when making your application, it is really important that you are aware of our entry requirements. I'm going to talk about A-level to begin with. So we have some general entry requirements for A-levels, and they are, if you are looking to study a pathway with three A-levels, we look for a minimum of 5 GCSEs, grade 4 to 9, which include English and maths. To study a pathway which might include 4 A-levels, you need a minimum of 7 GCSEs at grade 7, which include a minimum of 2 at grade 8. And you'll also be enrolled onto our scholarship programme, which Joe mentioned earlier on. Now, in addition to these general entry requirements, each A-level subject has its own specific requirements. And this is to ensure that applicants are suitable for the course and for the level of study that you are going to be engaging with. So I've shown two examples here. If we just have a look at the next slide. If we look at English literature, for example, the course requires a grade 5 and a grade 6 in written subjects, in addition to the entry requirements, the general entry requirements I've just mentioned. And one of those written subjects needs to be English language. And that's just making sure that we are confident that you're suitable for the level of study that you are going to be enrolling onto. Outside of A-levels, our vocational entry requirements, they differ course to course. So we strongly recommend that you view our entry requirements on the website. As my colleague Matt showed you a moment ago, each course you can click on more information and you can view our entry requirements. Now, my colleague Joe mentioned the scholar programme that we have at the Angel campus. And this is a new initiative for us this year, coming into September. The entry requirements that you can see just down the bottom there to the left are 7 GCSEs at grade 7 or above, including 2 grade 8s. And you can see that the purpose of this programme is to nurture and stretch academic and vocational excellence. Next slide, please. There are two options in order for you to be enrolled onto this programme. You can enrol with us in September, but there's also an option for you to be nominated onto the programme mid-year. Next slide, please. Features of the programme include specialist Oxbridge and Russell Group tutorials, academic research and masterclasses, and a range of different activities that we embed into a specialised tutorial programme. Next slide, please. And here you can see some more of these fantastic activities that Joe mentioned earlier on to you, which make up this scholar programme to really get our students ready for application to competitive universities. Thanks, Val.
Thank you, Brian. That was great. I've just got a question. There seems to be quite a lot of interest about the Scholars Programme. I know you mentioned the entry requirements. Can you just mention that again briefly? What are the entry requirements for the Scholars Programme?
Of course. So the entry requirements for the Scholar Programme is 7 GCSEs at grade 7 and above. And within that, we're looking for a minimum of 2 GCSEs at grade 8.
Okay, that's great.
So more information will be published about our scholar programme on the website very shortly after this event. As I said, it's a very exciting time for us at the campus. It's a brand new initiative that's coming in September. And Joe and all the team at the campus are working really hard to get this fantastic programme off the ground in September.
Thank you so much, Brian. Thanks for joining us. Okay, so next up we have a short testimonial from our vice principal for the student union. His name is Boz. Hi, Boz.
Hello.
Hi, how are you today?
Great, thank you. So as you heard, my name is Boz and I am the student union vice president. I study level 3 medical applied science in Angel campus. So let me start off by talking about the teachers and the staff. They're fantastic and overall the best in the college. They are reliable, welcoming, hardworking, no matter the circumstances we're in. They always find the time to help you. They will help you with anything from classwork to further choices in life, like going to university, apprenticeships. All through the college was closed, we continued our lessons so that I am ready for September. A few weeks ago, we also had an online tutorial on how to apply through UCAS and write our personal statement for university. In September, I will be working closely with careers on my university application. Student Services sends really helpful newsletters with links to articles we should read on careers we want to go into. The staff here push us to the best of our limit. As like most schools, we have staff assigned to support us for everything we do, so you get the support you need and deserve. Now let's talk about the changes you experience from secondary school to college. Firstly, you'll get a very flexible timetable that tells you when and where you need to be. In between lessons, you'll also have some free time. It's up to you how you want to spend it, with your friends, have lunch, or even go to the library to do some coursework. Secondly, you will receive a lot of homework and assignments throughout the year. This is because the BTEC marks you as you finish each subject. This way, you know how well you are doing on your courses and really motivates you to get those higher grades. The teachers are very understanding and supportive of our work. They are always there for you to talk to. We also do projects and experiments in the lab as groups, so we can practice our teamwork skills. As the year goes on, we learn lots of skills so that the work gets much easier. For all those that love attending clubs, we also have an array of different activities you can sign up to, including lots of different sports that we do at Sobel Centre. You can do projects in workshops and debating societies, and you can also become one of our student union class reps. You can also participate in activities such as the Duke of Edinburgh Award, which has lots of exciting challenges. I hope you like what you heard, and I hope to see you in CEN Islington College next year. Thank you. That's all from me.
Boss, thank you very much. That was great. Any advice on, I know you've spoken about your own experience and you have given lots of advice, but any advice on a student coming in and who wants to take part in the student union? What would be the best thing you'd advise them?
So I would advise you to actually make a lot of friends, not in just your class, but also throughout the school. The college. It's not that hard. Everyone's quite welcoming. Everyone's nice to each other. We don't have fights. Think of your class as a family, more like. So, and honestly, just always have your equipment, because when you don't have your equipment, it's really hard on yourself and the teachers. So make life easier for yourself and the teachers by bringing your equipment.
Great. Thank you so much. That's really reassuring to know. Fantastic. And it sounds like you've had a great experience at the Angel campus.
Oh, indeed I did.
Brilliant. Okay, Boz, thank you. Have a lovely day.
Thank you.
Okay. So next up, we have Sasha Merman, who is the head of school at the Angel campus. And hi, Sasha.
Hi there, Van, how are you? And great testimonial, Boz. It was really good to hear that feedback. Just nice to know that you've been enjoying your time there at the college. So my name is Sasha Merman and I run the BTEC Science and Engineering courses at Angel Campus. I'll be introducing some videos made by our students that'll give you an idea about what it's like to study on these courses. And then I'll be around to answer some questions for you after that. This afternoon, I'll be covering applied and medical science, health science, forensic science, and engineering. Our courses are quite different to A-levels as there are so many practical classes. So you'll see some of the activities we get up to in all the different courses in these videos. So the first video coming up is applied and medical science.
Caroline, I study BTEC Level 3 Applied Science. The teaching is very understandable. The teachers are so helpful, knowledgeable, and has vast experience with other organisations. With all its hard work for further opportunities in science, the lessons are very enjoyable and exceptional. Making friends is easily made in City and Islington because everyone is friendly and very helpful. During this course, there'll be a work placement which is mandatory. To gain some skills, you go away for a week without coming to college, do the work experience and receive a certificate at the end. Learning applied science is a good course because it opens so many doors for you in the future. Thank you. Bye.
Hello, I'm Eric. I take BTEC Level 3 National Foundation Diploma in Applied Science, Level 3. I like this course a lot. It helps a lot. The teachers teach you is fantastic, and it allows you to do a lot of practical work, and that practical work gives you a lot of skills, and those skills transfer over a lot. The only way you could really experience the work, or at least science, in my opinion, is through the practical work. Now, the lessons I've had are always so great, because most of the teachers just seem to love the subject, and they love it. You love it. And that kind of attitude really pushes you to do better. And the classrooms as well. You build a community with your class, and this community will last your course.
We think you should come to City and Islington.
Because not only does it help you academically,
but it helps you develop life skills.
And it gives you a variety of skills for the outside world.
And it helps you develop as an individual.
Hello, my name is Gozen and I study at City and Islington College. I've been at the college for about 2 years now, and it's a great, fun and friendly working environment. My favourite subject would have to be chemistry. This is because you get to do cool and fun experiments every other lesson. The teachers here are very helpful and they help you achieve the best grade possible. I highly recommend you come and study at City and Islington College as it's an experience you don't want to miss out on.
Hello, my name is Angela and I study medical science. I've studied at this college for nearly 2 years. The course covers a really wide range of topics, including laboratory techniques, physiology of the body, and human regulation. This course also allows you to progress in advanced degrees in science and medicine. I would highly recommend you to study at City and Islington College as the experience is unmatchable.
Hi, Sasha.
Yes, hi.
Hi, can we address some questions that we have in the audience, please?
Yeah, of course.
Okay, so we've got some students asking whether they can take a combination of A-levels and the vocational sciences. I know Brian touched upon the pathway programme earlier. Can you elaborate on that, please?
Yeah, so there are a couple of options starting this year where we are offering the medical science programme with one chemistry A-level, and we're also offering the health sciences programme with a biology A-level. And then we're going to get into engineering later on, but the engineering also is going to come with an option of either maths A-level or electronics A-level, depending on your sort of speciality.
Okay, and what are the entry requirements for someone who's choosing to do a vocational science and an A-level alongside?
They are slightly different for depending on whether it's the applied science or the health science and the engineering. So the details of those probably you can look at on the website. So I think it's grade six. In GCSE maths and English. So I can check the details on those on the website.
That's fine. And the scholars programme that was mentioned earlier, does that apply to the vocational sciences as well?
Yes, it does. We're definitely looking for our higher achievers on the BTEC programme too, because obviously, we get a lot of students every year who are not opting to take vocational courses because of their results, but actually because they really want to have a more practical experience of working in laboratories and applying knowledge as they're learning.
Sure. Can you tell me what enrichment programmes you run which complement the vocational sciences, like the applied science, health science as well?
Yeah, so we have now have access to all of the science clubs and engineering clubs that are running throughout the whole campus. So, for example, on engineering, there's been some work on building a go-kart in the Young Engineers Club. There's a chemistry club and a science club in the building. So we are able to allow students to access all of those enrichment classes.
That's great. Thank you very much, Sasha. OK, I think we're ready for your next section.
Thanks.
Hi, my name is Tassin and I'm currently studying health and social care. One thing I really enjoy about this course is the work experience. For this course, we are required to have a work experience placement, and this is either going to be chosen for us or we can choose them ourselves. My work experience placement was at a special needs primary school, and my job was basically to work alongside the teachers and help the kids throughout the day. During this placement, I learned a lot of new skills which would be required in any career path that I may take in the future. Another thing that I enjoy about this course is the lessons. During the lessons, the teachers try to get everyone involved as much as possible, and I find that very useful because when everyone is getting involved, everyone is having discussions and sharing their own opinions about a specific topic. This allows me to learn more about what other people are thinking and how it relates to the course.
I'm Mona Lisa, I'm at my first year of health and social care. I just wanted to say that this course is completely amazing. We do a lot of units such as anatomy, we talk about disorders, we talk about research, we talk about the different jobs that professionals do, and it's very helpful because if you don't really know what you actually want to do but you know you like science and you're just like helping people, it really gives you an insight of all the jobs and how are they done. And we actually got to do a role play and we got to experience how it feels when you work in a health and social care setting. We also did work experience, which I went to an activity centre for elderly people, and it was very helpful because I got to put everything that I learned in theory into the practical side of it, and it was just completely amazing. The teachers are just the best thing ever, especially my teacher Seema. She just makes everything that is hard and complicated into something very easy and relatable. And alongside that, you get literally amazing friends because it's just very nice to have people that just love and just very into what you're into as well, which is, you know, helping people. And I just wanted to say, for everyone that thinks that BTEC is just easy and health and social care is easy, wait until you're actually there, until you experience everything, doing a lot of things at the same time. But it's possible and it's challenging and it's very, very, very good to prepare you for, you know, future experiences and your future career. And I just wish everyone a good luck, and I hope you have the same good experience that I am experiencing.
Hi, I'm Samia Hawk, and I currently study my first year of Health and Social Care at City Institute Center for Applied Sciences. What I like about Candy is the environment, from dedicated teachers to friendly staff members, students, as well as having easily accessible resources and facilities. Health and Social Care is a course that is both theoretical and practical based, and the work experience provided to you is especially something to look forward to, as an insight of how specific work environment of your choice is provided, such as GPs, special needs schools, and many others. Lessons are engaging and fun from the very first day, and making friends is actually really easy, as you all share common interests, health and social care. This course is really great because at the end of the 2 years, it opens up to a variety of pathways to follow up with, such as progressing onto universities, progressing onto having a career, and progressing on to having an apprenticeship. This course is really great for people who want to help other people in all the aspects of their lives, mentally, physically, and many others.
Sorry, Sasha. Hi, could you just talk through health sciences, please, and where that progression is for students, and, you know, what areas they can go into in terms of higher education as well?
Yeah, so health science is probably one of our most vocationally focused courses that we run at Angel. The usual progression route for health science is to go into nursing or midwifery, although we do find a lot of the students end up do applying to university to do psychology. So the basis of the course is very focused on how it feels to work in the health and social care industry, and a work placement is a large part of the course, with students actually going for one day a week out working in the healthcare environment. And then the units that they take are very much applying the knowledge that they're learning in that workplace to their sort of academic work. So research that they do is based on the things that they're experiencing in the workplace.
Sure. And the entry requirements for health sciences, is that quite similar to the applied sciences, or do they vary quite substantially? Or
so the health sciences program is a little bit less heavy on the science, and therefore the entrance requirements for health science is a grade 4 in maths and English. So 4 GCSEs with a grade 4 in maths and English. And then for the science, we just need at least one of a combined science grade to be a grade 4, or if you took a single biology, that would also be fine at grade 4.
Great. And again, the enrichment you have enrichment programs to complement that?
Yes, we do. I mean, they're more focused on the biology side. So it would be more. Science.
Yeah. Okay. So next up,
why do you do forensic science? Why did you choose forensic science?
I chose forensic science because I'm interested in just forensic science in general, and like crime and evidence. And just looking into things like that, I find it very interesting.
I chose it so that when I go to uni, I can do psychology.
It's just interesting. It's about crime and like the drugs and all. Interesting as well.
We did one about the blood, that we had to see which one, like the types of blood that there were. I found that interesting.
The ones with the drugs like heroin and stuff like that, I think that was quite interesting because you could see the, for example, we had this a sample that was unknown, and we had to test different like samples. So there was like different kind of like poisons, and then there was like actual, not actual drugs, but the ones that reacted, like heroin, ecstasy, cocaine, stuff like that. And then that we found out that there was heroin and other, it was like a poison, I don't remember, but it was like mixed together, so to distribute more, kind of. And I thought that was interesting.
It's an interesting course, and that we have, it's very much split between a science focus and also the sort of criminology side of things, which is more of like a humanities base to the course. So you have to be a bit of an all-rounder to take the forensic science course, because you, in the first year, will be doing you know, some real foundation science, which is similar to physics, chemistry and biology A-level content. At the same time, you'll be learning about legislation and about the psychology, criminal psychology. In the second year, it tends to become more focused on the sort of detailed forensic units. But it is worth, you know, understanding that that first year has got quite a heavy duty science component to it. So you need to really make sure that science is something that you enjoy if you are to come on this course, as well as really being fascinated by the criminology and the crime world.
Sure. And so going forward with the whole pandemic and COVID, how is that impacted on the teaching? Especially, I would imagine a lot of it's practical as well as theory. So how has that been balanced and brought into the
classroom? So we've put together a program that we feel will still allow practical, the practical experience to continue, despite the fact that we're taking safety measures to make sure that the students and of course the staff remain safe and their families at home. So it will be a blended approach. And we were just looking at forensic science there. We have some amazing facilities at the Angel campus. The whole basement of the building is fitted out as a crime scene, where we can set up crimes where students can go and analyse evidence that they find, and then use the techniques that they've learnt in the lessons to work out who was the perpetrator of the crime. And all of that stuff is so integral to vocational courses that that will still be the sort of main component of the course as we go forward in into next year. There will be online teaching as well. And when the lockdown happened, we were doing 100% online teaching. And so the teachers have really been working on perfecting their style, because obviously it's a new type of teaching that people hadn't done before. But the science team, probably the best team around to be able to innovate and come up with really great ways of using the technology so that students really can engage and still get individualized feedback from the teachers.
That's great, Sasha, thank you. So next up we have a engineering video.
My name is Janaya and I am an engineer student at City and Islington College in Angel. The area is really great. I get to see businessmen and women and uni students that go to the uni not too far from the college. It really motivates me to do really well so I can go to uni like them, and just reminds me that I need to do well so I can progress in my education. I love all of my lessons, however my favourite has to be workshop, because you get to make an experiment with different materials. So far I've made a candle holder and a phone holder that has a box attached to it. In the future I would like to make a model aeroplane and use our 3D printer. I knew it was going to be a challenge moving to college with no one from my secondary school and being surrounded by mostly males. However, I had the support of my teachers in lessons and my tutor who really takes time with me. It's nice to just know that someone's going to be there for you if you ever need the help. I'm really glad that I decided to study engineering at City in Islington because at the end of the day, I could see that I've progressed in the course or in myself. Thank you for listening.
Hi, my name is Ali. I thoroughly enjoyed my 2 years studying engineering at City and Islington College. During my first year studying engineering at City and Islington College, we took part in a lesson called workshop where we could make projects such as pencil boxes and water filters. The staff at City and Islington College are extremely supportive as we continuously guide students during workshops and classwork and any other work-related tasks. We also encourage students to work hard and achieve their goals.
City and Islington College is located in central London, which has made it a very exciting place to go and study. I think that the college is also very accessible since you can get there by bus or even by trains. In my first year of college, my most enjoyable moments have always been in the workshop. The workshop is where we have our practical sessions and we use new materials in our projects. The college is full of wonderful teachers. The teachers are always so encouraging, always love to help. All members of staff are very approachable, which has made my time at City and Islington very nice.
Yeah. In year one of college, we had a number of workshop lessons in which we had designed and produced a number of different products. In year two of college, I was designing and producing an RC car that was able to be controlled via a phone. Staff members of the college are very supportive towards any difficulties of a student. The fact that we are able to have lessons during this lockdown period really shows how dedicated staff members are to providing an education for the students.
Hi Sasha, hi. So it shows that the students have had a great time as well at the campus in engineering. Apologies. I've got a question here from the audience. Do the students, as well as the theory and the practical side, do they get a chance to take part in competitions that are held in the industry and award ceremonies?
Yes, I mean, I think the go-kart that they are producing is something that is entered into a competition, and there are also opportunities at local industry to be involved in something in particular within Marsat previously has been done. So there is also been a coding competition that was, since we took on the new qualification in engineering, the focus has really moved on to programming and microcontroller systems. So as opposed to maybe we're looking to the new generation really of engineering by taking that pathway. And so they are having an opportunity then to enter into coding competitions as well, moving forward with this new qualification.
Sure. So it is embracing new technology as well as theory and everything. Okay, Sasha, thank you very much for your time. It's been really informative. That's great. Okay, so up next we have Matthew Farmer, who will be talking about our animal management science courses. Hi, Matthew.
Hi there. Hi, everybody.
How are you today?
Yeah, very good. Thank you. Very good.
Great. Thanks for joining us.
No problem at all.
Tell us a bit about your department and animal care?
Absolutely. So in 2021, the Animal Sciences Department will be offering Level 1, Level 2 and Level 3 courses. The Level 1, although it's called a land-based studies course, is actually heavily all about animals still. Level 2, Animal Care and Level 3 courses are all about animal. Level 1 and Level 2 courses are on a curriculum where the only assessments are done by assignment work, whereas the Level 3 course that we offer, there are a couple of units where you will be assessed with external examinations.
Okay, great. So I believe you have a video for us today.
I believe so, yes.
Okay, and we go.
So this is where you guys will come on through so you can carry out the practical components to your course. But before we go and check out the animals, just note that we have modified the hallways to make sure that you guys stay 2 meters apart and we can keep everybody safe. Okay, so come on in.
And this is the prep room, where you guys will be preparing feeds for your animal nutrition unit, or you could be preparing some topical medicines for your health unit, or maybe some enrichment for all of your units. And this is a small glimpse of our mammal room, where you guys will be working to make sure that you learn how to safely restrain, handle, clean, feed, enrich, and just provide the basic husbandry to all of our fluffy little friends. This is our cold blooded room, where you guys will be showing how to safely handle the strain and even provide a nutritious meal for all of our reptiles, invertebrates, amphibians and arachnids. We hope you enjoyed the virtual tour of the animal unit, but what you need to do now is head over to City and Islington College's website, where you can apply for a position on the animal management course, where a team of dedicated staff are ready and waiting for you to join the course, and we can help and support you achieve the qualifications you require. Okay, we hope to see you in the new academic year. Goodbye for now.
Hi, my name is Noah, and this is Lauren the Garden Snail, and I'm a first year student at City and Islington in the Animal Management Level 3 course. I think the course is really interesting. There are a lot of things you can learn, ranging from animal behaviour to animal welfare to learning how to bathe a tortoise. The teachers are really nice and caring, and they will thoroughly explain something to you if you don't understand it. And not to mention, the animals in the Animal Centre are quite incredible. We've got invertebrates ranging from jungle nymphs to giant millipedes, and then you've got your reptiles ranging from chameleons to even a hognose snake. They've also got a wide range of mammals ranging from rodents to even monkeys. Well, not baboons, but you've got pygmy marmosets, which are pretty cool. They've also got a few birds. Just be careful of Darwin the horned macaw. He might bite you, but if you're nice and you feed him a blueberry, you'll be okay. In terms of the future, I would really like to do a veterinary course in university, and I know that the teachers and the lessons will definitely help achieve that goal, because all the teachers are really respectful and kind, and the lessons are all well thought out, and the assignments aren't even that hard, so you guys don't have to worry about that. Okay. So yeah. So I hope this small video helps you decide what you want to do in terms of college courses. This course is truly amazing, and I think everyone will like it, because who doesn't like animals? So yeah. Say bye, Simba. Goodbye.
Okay. Matthew, could you just talk a bit about the let's say the practical side and the examinations, if any, on the course?
Absolutely. So practical side, on the level one and level two versions of the animal courses, there's no less than about 50 to 60% of your time will be involved in doing animal practicals. So that will be within our animal centre, with an array of animals across the different taxonomic groups. So invertebrates, reptiles, mammals, fishes and birds. And so those, the level one and level two are very heavily practical. At level three, you're still involved almost every day within animal practicals in the animal centre, but just to a slightly lesser extent, because there are a few more academic units where the assessments aren't just practical based. You might be preparing for a few exams as well. In terms of assessment, a lot of the assessment at level one will be on you performing practical work within the animal centre, as well as written work that you're doing in alignment with the practical work that you might be performing. At level three, you're going to have that combination of assessment whereby you are writing assignments, but you will still have a small component that will be externally assessed as well with written exams at certain periods through the calendar year.
Okay, and from my knowledge, I believe the animal care department have invested quite heavily in the facilities. Could you explain a bit about that?
Absolutely. So in the last 18 months, we have completely redeveloped the internal animal care centre, and we've now got specialist rooms for mammals, fishes, and we've got a cold-blooded room as well, which houses our reptiles, amphibians and invertebrates. And we've got an outside bird section as well as a few mammals outside. So this has all been redeveloped and gives a nice variety of the different animals across the different taxonomic groups to support your learning.
That's great. Thank you very much, Matthew. That's been great. Very informative. And the facilities look absolutely incredible. Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. Next, we have Chris Simmons, who is the head of school for sports science and public services. Hi, Chris. How are you today?
Hi, Val. I'm good. Thank you.
Good. Okay. I believe you have a video for us, or would you like to talk a bit about your department first, just to introduce it?
Yeah, I'm the head of school for sports, public services and a few other areas. We've got a range of courses from level one to level three running next year. What you're about to see is a few testimonies from our students about their experiences on the course.
Great. Look forward to it.
My name is Alexandra Pescu. I just completed my level 3 sports science at CTN Islington. I'm an amateur boxer. I've been competing for 2 years and a half. And one thing I like about the college is that the staff is really lovely. And about the course, I will say fitness testing is one of my favourite modules, and nutrition, as they teach me and push me to my limit, especially fitness testing is also quite competitive with the classmates.
I'm Jason De Silva, I'm 19 years old, and I studied for 2 years at St. Islington College doing an extended diploma in sports science. During that time, I learned a lot of life skills, the main one being marketing myself, so I'm prepared to put myself in the workplace and give myself the opportunities to get into the workplace. During the course, I was also given opportunities to get a diploma in sports coaching. We had the option between personal training, sports coaching. I personally went for sports coaching, and it just gave me more confidence in myself and also taught me to be a lot more organized.
From my personal experience at the college, I cannot recommend the college enough, as I went from achieving not so good grades at other college to smashing the best grades possible for all of my assignments. Honestly, I would not be able to do that without the teachers. They're great, they're really supportive, and they make their lessons super interesting. Join us at City of Islington College, Sport and Exercise Science.
Hi, my name is Freddie Kurt. I'm a current
student at City of Islington studying Level 3 Public Services. The reason why I chose this course is because I've always had a passion to be a police officer, and this was the best option to help me get there. In this course, you learn about the court system and the powers a police officer may and do not have. You'll also learn about the effects crime has on society and a person itself. But this course is also great for other fields of the public service, such as the fire brigade, paramedics and the army. So if you want to join one of these fields, this is why you should choose this course, and that's why I chose this course.
Hello, my name is Dylan. I'm 19 years old. I'm currently studying public services level 3 at City of Islington College. The reason why this course is good for me is because as I'm planning to join the police force in the future, this course has got so many different benefits to it. You get to work on your own skills, you get to speak to paramedics, you get to speak to police officers, you get to speak to firefighters and see what they experience day to day, and so that gives you a bigger picture of what you would like to do in the future, what career you would like to get into, and yeah.
Hi, my name is Wesley Guy, and the course that I studied at college was Public Services Level 3. I really took interest into this course, and I really think that it will help me with my further education down the line. This course is really interesting, and the fact that it has different units does help for everyone in general to find their perfect area of studies, to help them find a specific course to study at university. So the course I'll be studying at university will be Criminology and Youth Studies, as I've really taken an interest in this course.
Hello, my name is Asan, and I've studied Public Services Level 3 in college, and I had a brilliant experience studying that course. Honestly, there's a lot of units that that are just fascinating to study, and I feel like I've learned a lot while studying those units, especially when it comes to like Unit 22 Law. I've learned a lot within that unit. It opens gates for everything you really want to do in public services. It doesn't matter what sector you want to go into. It's a brilliant unit, and overall, it was brilliant for me because I learned a lot, and I will be going to do criminology in uni.
Hello, my name is Razi, and I am a student at Candy studying Public Services Level 3. I am going into my second year. Honestly, the first year of public services, level 3, was such an amazing year. The teachers were so helpful. The course content is amazing. You do physical activities. We've been doing fitness, and we've been learning about policing and how it works, all the legal system. It is amazing, honestly. I can never, ever wish for another course to go into. All the teachers are fantastic. The support is there. We're in a friendly environment. It's just a fantastic course to get in. So I hope my comments on the courses helps you, and I hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
Chris, that's great. You've got some amazing testimonials of existing students. We've got some questions about higher education courses, like the opportunities once people complete sports science. Where does that take them? You know, which levels, you know, can, well, after doing a level 3 program, can they go on to university or straight into work? Can you explain that?
Yeah, the course will give you both options. There's lots of units that you study over the 2 years. There's nutrition, psychology, anatomy, physiology, and that enables you to progress on to lots of sports science related courses at university, such as strength and conditioning, sport and exercise science, sports therapy, sports nutrition. So there's lots of HE opportunities for our students, and the majority of our students do go off on that route to university. But it also has a lot of practical units like fitness testing, fitness training. So it does prepare students for getting a job as a coach or a fitness instructor. So if after the 2 years you want to go and get a job and explore the workplace, we try and get you prepared for that as well.
That's great. And in terms of the facilities, I know some of the students touched on that. I know you've got state-of-the-art gym facilities. Can you explain a bit more about that?
Yeah, we've got two main facilities that we use on a sports course. We've got a sports hall, which is just down the road from the college. It's recently rebuilt, top-of-the-range facilities. The NBA basketball teams, when they come to London for their annual fixture, use that as a training base. That's how good it is. And our gym, which is on-site, recently got refurbished with new equipment. literally a week before lockdown. So the students that come next year will be the first students to lift the weights in the new gym.
Wow, great. So you touched on basketball there. Is that something the Angel campus is thinking of introducing?
Yeah, there's a basketball team that is part of the enrichment provision at the college. We are looking at, if not this year, in the near future, trying to establish a basketball academy at the college. And we encourage and really insist that all our sports students are participating in sport and fitness on a regular basis, whether that's the college teams or when we open the gym up for personal fitness sessions, that you are regularly engaged with sport.
Great. Thank you very much. Thanks, Chris. That's been great. Okay, have a good day. Right. So I would just like to say thank you to everyone who's attended and taken part in this event. I hope everyone has got the information they needed. For those questions that have not been answered in the online Q&A facility, please do leave your email address so that we can contact you and provide you all the necessary information. This video will be live on the college website shortly. If you want any further information, please email us on courseinfo@candy.ac.uk, or you can also use the chat facility where someone will be there to answer any questions you have. And please do also go on the college website to make your application for your chosen course. Thank you so much. Goodbye.